Welcome to Module 1 of Digital Signal Processing. In this module, we are going to see what signals actually are. We're going to go through a history, see the earliest examples of discrete time signals. Actually, it goes back to Egyptian times. Then, through this history, see how digital signals, for example, with the telegraph signals, became important in communications. And today, how signals are pervasive in many applications in everyday life objects. For this, we're going to see what the signal is, what a continuous time analog signal is, what the discrete time continuous amplitude signal is, and how these signals relate to each other and are used in communication devices. We are not going to have any math in this first module. It's more illustrative, and the mathematics will come later in the class. This is an introduction to what digital signal processing is all about. Before getting going, let's give some background material. There is a textbook called Signal Processing for Communications by Paolo Prandoni and myself. You can have a paper version, or you can get the free PDF or HTML version on the website here, indicated on the slide. There will be quizzes, there will be homework sets, and there will be occasional complimentary lectures. What is actually a signal? We talk about digital signal processing, so we need to define what the signal is. Typically, it's a description of the evolution of a physical phenomenon. For example, if I speak here, there is sound pressure waves going through the air that will be picked up by a microphone, and that's a typical signal. When you listen to this speech, there is a loudspeaker creating a sound pressure waves that reaches your ear, and that's another signal. However, in between is the world of digital signal processing. Because after the microphone, it gets transformed in a set of numbers, it is processed in the computer, it is being transferred through the internet, finally it is decoded to create a sound pressure wave to reach your ears. Other examples are the temperature evolution over time, the magnetic deviation, for example on a LP recording, the gray level on paper for a black and white photograph, the flickering colors on a TV screen. Here we have a thermometer recording temperature over time. So you see the evolution, and there are discrete ticks, and you see how it changes over time. So what are the characteristics of digital signals? There are two key ingredients. First, there is discrete time. As we have seen in the previous slide, on the horizontal axis, there are discrete, evenly spaced ticks, and that corresponds to a discretization in time. There is also discrete amplitude, because the numbers that are measured will be represented in a computer and cannot have some infinite precision. So what about more sophisticated things, functions, derivative, and integrals? It's a question of discrete versus continuous, or analog versus discrete, goes probably back to the earliest time of science, for example, to the School of Athens. There was a lot of debate between philosophers and mathematicians about the idea of continuum, or the difference between countable things and uncountable things. So in this picture, you see green are famous philosophers like Plato, and red famous mathematicians like Pythagoras, somebody that we are going to meet again in this class. And there is a famous paradox, which is called Zeno's paradox. So if you shoot an arrow, will it ever arrive at destination? We know that physics allows us to verify this, but mathematics had a problem with this, and we can see this graphically. So you want to go from A to B, you cover half of the distance, that is C, then a quarter, that's D, another eighth, that's E, etc. Will you ever get there? And of course, we know you get there because the sum from 1 to infinity of 1 over 2 to the n is equal to 1, a beautiful formula that we'll see several times reappearing in this class. Unfortunately, during the Middle Ages in Europe, things were a bit lost. As you can see, people had other worries. In the 17th century, things picked up again. Here we have a physicist, an astronomer, Galileo, and a philosopher, René Descartes, and both contributed to the advancement of mathematics at that time. Descartes' idea was simple but powerful. Start with a point, put it into a coordinate system, then put more sophisticated things like lines, and you can use algebra. This led to the idea of calculus, which allowed to mathematically describe physical phenomena. For example, Galileo was able to describe the trajectory of a bullet using infinitesimal variations in both the horizontal and vertical direction. Calculus itself
was formalized by Newton and Leibniz and is one of the great advances of mathematics in the 17th and 18th century. It is time to do some very simple continuous time signal processing. We have a function in blue here between a and b, and we would like to compute its average. As is well known, this will be the integral of the function divided by the length of the interval, and it is shown here in red dots. What would be the equivalent in discrete time signal processing? We have a set of samples between, say, 0 and capital N minus 1. The average is simply 1 over n, the sum of the individual terms xn between 0 and capital N minus 1. Again, it is shown in the red dotted line. In this case, because the signal is very smooth, the continuous time average and the discrete time average are essentially the same. This was nice and easy, but what if the signal is too fast and we don't know exactly how to compute either the continuous time operations or an equivalent operation on samples? Enters Joseph Fourier, one of the greatest mathematicians of the 19th century and the inventor of Fourier series, Fourier analysis, which are essentially the ground tools of signal processing. We show simply a picture to give the idea of Fourier analysis. It is a local Fourier spectrum, as you would see, for example, on an equalizer table in a disco, and it shows the distribution of power across frequencies, something we are going to understand in detail in this class. But to do discrete time processing of continuous time signals, we need some further results. And these were derived by Harry Nyquist and Claude Shannon, two researchers at Bell Labs. They derived the so-called sampling theorem, first appearing in the 1920s and then formalized in 1948. If the function x of t is sufficiently slow, then there is a simple interpolation formula for x of t. It's the sum of the samples xn interpolated with a function that is called the sinc function. It looks a little bit complicated now, but it's something we're going to study in great detail because it's one of the fundamental formulas linking discrete time and continuous time signal processing. Let us look at this sampling in action. So we have the blue curve. We take samples, the red dots. From the samples, we use the sinc interpolation. We put one blue curve, second one, third one, fourth one, etc. When we sum them all together, we get back the original blue curve. It is magic. This interaction of continuous time and discrete time processing is summarized in these two pictures. On the left, you have a picture of the analog world. On the right, you have a picture of the discrete or digital world, as you would see in a digital camera, for example. And this is because the world is analog. It has continuous time, continuous space, and the computer is digital. It is discrete time, discrete amplitude. When you look at an image taken with a digital camera, you may wonder what the resolution is. And here we have a picture of a bird. This bird happens to have very high visual acuity, probably much better than mine. Still, if you zoom into the digital picture, after a while, around the eye here, you see little squares appearing, showing indeed that the picture is digital. It has discrete values over the domain of the image, and it also has actually discrete amplitude, which we cannot quite see here at this level of resolution. As we said, the key ingredients are discrete time and discrete amplitude for digital signals. So let us look at x of t, here it's a sinusoid, and investigate discrete time first. We see this with xn, and discrete amplitude. We see this with these levels of the amplitudes, which are also discretized. And so this signal looks very different from the original continuous time signal x of t. It has discrete values on the time axis, discrete values on the vertical amplitude axis. So why do we need digital amplitude? Well, because storage is digital, because processing is digital, and because transmission is digital. And we're going to see all of these in sequence. So data storage, which is of course very important, used to be purely analog. You had paper, you had wax cylinders, you had vinyl, you had compact cassettes, VHS, etc. In imagery, you had Kodachrome slides, Super 8 film, etc. Very complicated. A whole biodiversity of analog storages. In digital, much simpler. There is only zeros and ones. So all digital storage, to some extent, looks the same. The storage medium might look very different. So here you have a collection of storage from the last 25 years. However, fundamentally, there are only zeros and ones on these storage devices. So in that sense, they are all compatible with each other. Processing also moved from analog to digital. On the left side, you have a few examples of analog processing devices, an analog watch, an analog amplifier. On the right side, you have a piece of code. Now, this piece of code could run on many different digital computers. It would be compatible with all these digital platforms. The analog processing devices are essentially incompatible with each other. Data transmission has also gone from analog to digital. So let's look at a very simple model here. You have on the left side the transmitter, you have a channel, on the right side you have a receiver. What happens to analog signals when they are sent over a channel? So x of t goes to the channel, it's first multiplied by 1 over g because there is path loss, and then there is noise added, indicated here with a sigma of t. The output is x hat of t. Let's start with some analog signal x of t, multiply it by 1 over g, and add some noise. How do we recover a good reproduction of x of t? Well, we can compensate for the path loss, so we multiply by g to get x hat 1 of t. But the problem is that x1 hat of t is x of t, that's the good news, plus g times sigma of t. So the noise has been amplified. Let's see this in action. We start with x of t. We scale by g, we add some noise, we multiply by g, and indeed now we have a very noisy signal. This was the idea behind transatlantic cables, which were laid in the 19th century and were essentially analog devices until telegraph signals were properly encoded as digital signals. As can be seen in this picture, this was quite an adventure to lay a cable across the Atlantic and then to try to transmit analog signals across these very long distances. For a long channel, because the path loss is so big, you need to put repeaters. So the process we have just seen would be repeated capital N times. Each time the path loss would be compensated, but the noise would be amplified by a factor of N. Let us see this in action. So start with x of t, path loss by g, added noise, amplification by g with the amplification of the noise and the signal. For the second segment, we have the path loss again, so x hat 1 is divided by g and added noise. Then we amplify to get x hat 2 of t, which now has twice an amount of noise, 2g times sigma of t. So if we do this n times, you can see that the analog signal after repeated amplification is mostly noise, and that becomes problematic to transmit information. In digital communication, the physics do not change. We have the same path loss, we have added noise. However, two things change. One is that we don't send arbitrary signals, but for example, only signals that take values +1 and -1, and we do some specific processing to recover these signals. Specifically, at the output of the channel, we multiply by g, and then we take the signum operation. So x1 hat is signum of x of t plus g times sigma of t. Let us again look at this in action. We start with a signal x of t that is either +5 or -5. It goes through the channel, so it loses amplitude by a factor of g, and there is some noise added. We multiply by g, so we recover x of t plus g times the noise sigma t. Then we apply the thresholding operation, and sure enough, we recover a +5, -5 signal, which is identical to the ones that were sent on the channel. Thanks to digital processing, the transmission of information has made tremendous progress. In the mid-19th century, a transatlantic cable would transmit 8 words per minute. That's about 5 bits per second. 100 years later, a coaxial cable with 48 voice channels had already 3 megabits per second. In 2005, fiber optic technology allowed 10 terabits per second. A terabit is 10 to the 12 bits per second. And today, in 2012, we have fiber cables with 60 terabits per second. On the voice channels, the one that is used for telephony, in the 1950s you could send 1200 bits per second. In the 1990s that was already 56 kilobits per second. Today, with ADSL technology, we are talking about 24 megabits per second. Please note that the last module in the class will actually explain how ADSL works using all the tricks in the box that we are learning in this class. It is time to conclude this introductory module. And we conclude with a picture. If you zoom into this picture, you see the motto of the class. Signal is strength.